Dear Diary.
Dear Diary.
Dear Diary.
Dear Diary, my teen angst bullshit has a body count.
Dear Diary. Words heard in virtually every genre used to signify the quintessential all-American girl. Or the vapid airhead boy crazy girl, either works. But how did diary keeping become so intertwined with our concept of girlhood? Allow me to introduce the concept of bedroom culture.
Hi, my name is Annabeth, and I'm the one who runs this website. I study gender and media at the University of Alabama, and I particularly focus on girls' culture. And if you didn't know, there is an entire field of study looking at girls. Not women, not kids, not teenagers, but girls. So that's any female, girl, gender-identified person, you know, under the age of 25. Girls' studies kind of branched off from youth studies, that's looking at kids and teenagers in general, and women and gender studies, which is looking at adults, because some scholars realize that you can't really understand the culture and the behaviors and the socialization of girls in the same way that you would a woman or a typical kid, which of course to academia means boys.
When these scholars started looking at history, specifically focusing on what was happening to and with girls, they realized something interesting. Pretty much since the inception of the family unit as we know it, girls have been forced to live private lives. In early Western history, we saw this take place through the separate worlds ideology. Men and boys lived in the public sphere because they were physically stronger, but more inclined toward the morally corrupt outside world, while women and girls stayed in the private sphere due to their meek nature but strong moral compass. Girls in the 1800s were raised to be angels in the home, learning domestic arts such as cooking and sewing. And isn't it interesting that arts like sculpture and painting, which were historically only available to men and are made to exist in the public sphere, are considered fine art with strong cultural significance, while private arts, such as embroidery, are thought of as arts and crafts? By the 1950s, most girls in the Western world had moved from a shared domestic sphere with their mothers to a smaller, even more private world all their own, the bedroom. Enter images of poster-covered walls, record players, then stereos and Bluetooth speakers, a place to try on outfits or experiment with makeup, and discuss movies, music, fashion, or more simply, culture, with your friends. Girls have been powerful cultural producers for as long as girls have existed. When we only look at the history of culture through public spheres, the impact of girls are left out. Take fan culture, for instance. Girls have been writing fan fiction, drawing fan art, and crafting cosplays for everything from comic books to boy bands for decades, long before the internet made cosplay babe a hot attainable status. Girls have shaped the way we understand books, music, fashion, and art for forever, but the ways they've done so go unnoticed, are often lost to history.
So, what does this have to do with diaries? The long-winded point I'm trying to make is that girls have always been forced to keep their thoughts, their ideas, their art, and their wisdom to themselves by keeping a diary. There's Joey. That's Joey, in case you see him sleeping back there. Keeping a diary is considered a girly thing because guys don't need to diary. If they have something to say, they have always been allowed to say it. If they had something to write, they've always had a way to share their writing publicly. And of course, I'm speaking very generally. I'm speaking about upper to middle class white guys because boys of color, men of color, poor boys, that kind of thing, didn't necessarily have the same avenues for self-expression historically as their white privileged counterparts did. But generally speaking, our mainstream idea of culture has been dominated by the idea that guys exist in the public and girls exist in the private. So if a guy has a big idea, they have a way to make it reality. They don't have to keep it to themselves. Not to mention this general idea that boys don't have feelings. If a boy were to write about his thoughts for his sake and his own sake only, that would be a little bit too touchy-feely. If you put your thoughts in a diary, it's emotional gush. If you put your thoughts in a book, it's literature.
Keeping a diary is a healthy way to process the world around us. It's a great way to try out new things, such as drawing or writing poetry. It helps us remember the important moments in our lives and make sense of our feelings. Think about how helpful it must be for historians to have all these girls' intimate written accounts of their lives. Hello, Anne Frank. We couldn't possibly understand cultural history as closely as we do without diaries. The hugely popular American Girl dolls, they're so painstakingly historically accurate, both in style of dress and in the spirit of the times they portray, because they are based on the actual diary entries of real-life girls who lived through slavery, the Great Depression, and more.
So keep your diary, girl, public or private. You don't have to keep it so it can be an important tool for historians one day. You don't have to keep it for anyone but you. Diaries like Anne Frank's can certainly become important historical tools and pieces of public art, but my point isn't to convince you that domestic arts such as diary keeping have to be made public to be celebrated. My point is that art doesn't have to be public to be worth something. There is power in private art. When we create private art, it exists only for us, only to be beautiful or sad or scary or nonsensical. It exists only to be understood by the one who wrote it. You're not beholden to any rules. You don't have to think about how it might seem to other people. It's to help you make sense of what's going on in your head, and that's powerful.